Books on Tape presents Luncheon of the Boating Party by Susan Vreeland, read by Karen White. To him who is specially hers, Joseph Kip Gray, from she who is singularly his, in memory of his brother, Michael Francis Gray. To my mind, a picture should be something pleasant, cheerful, and pretty. Yes, pretty. There are too many unpleasant things in life as it is, without creating still more of them. Pierre Auguste Renoir. Whatever you can do, or dream you can, begin it. Boldness has genius, power, and magic in it. Johann Wolfgang von Goethe. Chapter 1. La Vie Moderne. 20th July, 1880. He rode the awkward steam cycle along the ridge to catch glimpses of the domes and spires of Paris to the east, then turned west and careened headlong down the long, steep hill toward the village of Bougival and the Seine. With his right elbow cast in plaster, he could barely reach the handlebar, but he had to get to the river. Not next week, not tomorrow, now. Idleness had been itching him worse than the maddening tickle under the cast. Only painting would be absorbing enough to relieve them both. Steam hissed out of the engine, but it built up inside of him. He reached down to open the throttle wider. The soft morning light would be flattened to a glare by the time he got there if he didn't let her go all out. The piston beat faster in the cylinder until it became a whirr of sound. The poplars and chestnuts along the road a blur of greens, the blooming genêt a blaze of yellow, with the blue-green sweep of the river coming closer and closer. A painting. He was plunging into a painting. Down and down he plunged. Warm summer air filled his nose with the fragrance of honeysuckle, and the low-pitched honk of a tugboat urged him onward. At the base of the hill, he checked behind him to see that his folding easel, canvas, and Bazile's wooden color box were still strapped on. The three-wheeled cycle took the humped bridge at Bougival fine, but the coarse sand on the narrow connected islands made the front wheel wobble. All types of canoe, rowing yoles, sailboats, and racing sculls, tied to posts along the riverbank, produced inverted images quivering in the lazy current, deliciously paintable. But not today. They were empty of life. On Sundays, though, every laundress with her chapped red arms, every shop girl, mail clerk, butcher, and banker, Parisians of all classes took their leisure either on the Seine or in it or along its grassy slopes. La Grenouillère, the frog pond, one of the many rustic guinguettes along the river that provided food, music, and dancing, had a lonely air about it now compared to Sundays. Then, pleasure-loving Parisians threw off their city restraints and filled the floating café, shouted from rented rowboats, splashed each other in the shallow eddies, picnicked along the bank, drank and danced on the anchored barge, the way he and Claude Monet had painted it a decade ago. They had slapped each other on the back the day they'd discovered that juxtaposed patches of contrasting color could show the movement of sunlit water. What he would give for another day like that one, for that thrill of breaking new ground. Repeating safe, easy methods, portrait after portrait, as he'd been doing lately, was suffocating him. In the distance, a catboat sailing toward him looked like the Iris, one of Gustave's boats. He rowed toward it. Yes, it was. He stood up to his full height on the foot platforms, twisted to hail him with his left arm, and lost his balance. The front wheel jerked sideways, and the cycle tipped and crashed onto its side. His right hip and shoulder struck sand and gravel, his hand and elbow in the cast taking the fall, his face taking the bounce. The broken smokestack landed on his left leg. His right leg was trapped under one rear wheel, while the other rear wheel spun with a tick, tick, tick. Boiling water splashed and oil leaked onto his pant leg. He struggled to disentangle himself before getting burned. Jesus Christ! He would destroy himself if he didn't start painting soon. He spit out sand and lay trembling in a cloud of steam, trying to figure out what had happened and watching the glints of light riding the water. How different the colors from this low angle, the contrast between tips of ripples and valleys between them more pronounced now. A deeper forest green for the furrows, with shifting patches of yellow-green and ochre on the humps, and the silver highlights more transparent than he'd ever seen them. My God, to show that to the world. A throbbing moved up through his legs, hip, shoulder. His right cheek and hand stung. Sand had scoured his palm and left it bloody. He staggered to his feet. Bazile's dear old color box had suffered too, the corners splintered, one hinge sprung, the other twisted. Tubes and brushes lay scattered in the tall grasses, the canvas face down in a muddy patch. The Iris, with Gustave oblivious at the helm, was only a triangle of white sail downriver. Using his left arm and all his weight, he tried to pull the cycle upright, but it refused to budge. The monster weighed more than he did. The front wheel was bent. He could never steer it now. He turned off the oil burner and opened the steam release valve. The hissing quieted to a gurgle. Below the trademark, Peugeot, he saw the model name. La vie moderne. Modern life. He chortled. That was the subject matter of the new painting movement, as precarious as the steam cycle. He crouched at the river's edge and cupped some water in his left hand to rinse his mouth. A pain shot up his thigh. He splashed his right hand to loosen the grit embedded in his palm. The cool water stung. He crawled through the weeds to gather his brushes and tubes, but couldn't find yellow ochre. If he were well off, or at least stable, he could do without it because he could make it from other colors. But those tubes were almost squeezed flat already. A muttering duck glided between reeds toward a tube of paint. He quacked at it in a tone that said, "Leave it alone." The duck paddled away. The scent of wild roses assailed him. Any other time, the sight of them would have excited him, their petal faces pale pink and cream like women's cheeks, like Jeanne's. At least he'd found his beloved bicycle cap. Now all he needed was to find his way. In painting, in love, in life. He carried brushes in his right hand and the color box of his dead friend in his left, the lid dangling. He set off limping the 10-minute walk along the wooded strip to the Ile du Chateau. Just north of the railroad bridge, he would come to Maison Fournaise, the boater's guinguette, the riverside restaurant, hotel, and boat rental frequented by painters and writers, where he had thought to try out an idea on the little canvas. Up ahead, Alphonse Fournaise, the barrel-chested son of the owner, hoisted a narrow-prowed one-man canoe off carpenter's sawhorses and over his head as if it were a giant baguette. He ambled to the bank, lowered the boat, and slid it into the water. "Auguste Renoir, you old fool," Alphonse called. "You've either been in a boxing ring or you fell off your cycle again." "The latter, of course. I left it in the path just this side of La Grenouillère. The front wheel is bent. There's a muddy canvas there, too." "I'll go get them. Are you all right?" "I'll find out tomorrow when I try to get out of bed." Alphonse tied the boat to the dock. "Alphonsine!" he called to his sister, who was swimming nearby, and waved her in. Auguste watched her strong arms propel her through the water. When she climbed up the bank, her swimming costume of striped blouse and knee-length bloomers clung to her curves. Water slid down her shapely legs. Mon Dieu, Auguste, what happened? Alphonsine dried off with a towel as he explained. He set down his color box on the table under the trellised arbor and lowered himself gingerly onto the wooden chair. I'll get something to wash you. He felt blood trickle down his cheek. In a moment, she reappeared with two basins, soapy water and clear, and two cloths. Spears of light shone through the vine above her and danced in patches on her small, mounded breasts. Her nipples poked out like beads under the thin, wet fabric. Look at me, she said. I am. I mean, look up. Dutifully, he raised his face to hers. Her skin shone rosy from the sun, exactly what he loved to paint. Like Jeanne's cheeks.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.